late game and they lose to one engage, so.
You're notably referencing that CJ game where they took a couple of Barons, had fifth Dragon stacks, and just couldn't find a way to win. That's kind of been Jhené's problem recently, is that closing out games, whether it's side win minion control, whether it's just breaking the base, they've struggled.
They have. So, Rumble and Ezreal, our first two bans for KT. Apparently Nagne doesn't want to play that. There's the Azir against Nagne, maybe wanting to force him onto a Victor. Kuzan, we haven't seen a lot from this guy in the current meta. Three Azir games, but he also played LeBlanc and Lissandra and Cassiopeia, champions that are not really high priority anymore.
I'm excited to see him again in another high-pressure environment. When he played against SKT, he actually did very well against Faker in lane. So I was kind of wondering how he would do with an extended run in the team. No guarantee we're going to see that, but starting him against KT in what is a very important match in terms of the standing is at least a vote of confidence for Kuzan.
Yeah, certainly is. So Annie will be banned against Che, pretty common ban even before Annie was meta. Ryze rounds out our bans in this game. KT has a lot to choose from. They could go for the Gragas, they could go for the Alistar, they could go for the Victor. No Nidalee ban for the first time in a while, actually, against Jhené.
Very pointed edge to Nagne's champion pool most of the times. Not really known for really throwing in a lot of champions. The Victor he hadn't done a lot of winning on, so I don't mind him giving that away. GBM's actually played a wonderful Victor. I think Kuzan's maybe 1-0 on that champion.
He's never played it professionally.
Oh, wow, so it's not even one that he's shown. He has, I believe, four unique champion wins and then a couple of losses on the Azir to round out that first victory. So he's going to consider taking away the Victor. It's a lot open, though, so how do they actually answer this first pick Gragas? I mean, you don't need to feel pressured to pick up the Rek'Sai. Definitely a lot of jungle options available.
Yes, to be sure. And, you know, interestingly, there are so many Rek'Sai bans against Jhené. They actually hold a 30% ban rate of Rek'Sai against them, because if you give Chaser a lot of information in the early game, he can really run circles around you, so it can be a bit risky to go ahead and take that, but we will see the Victor and the Alistar locked in. Expected picks when the jungle no longer that priority.
I mean, you only need to look back to that series against Spenu where there was that game where Chaser was all over catch with Rek'Sai, just killing him in his jungle. It was it was rude.
Yeah.
So Chaser can present many different questions, whether it's the Nidalee for the high damage ganking threat, whether it's the Rek'Sai for the CC threat. If we see a Maokai come through, I wouldn't be surprised to see the Nidalee because it makes it more reliable. KT, very early rotation Kog'Maw potentially coming through.
Yeah, we've just seen it over about the last week and a half rise dramatically in terms of priority in the pick phase. So, Jhené, they like to run kite comps with Victor. They like to run Victor, Sivir, Nidalee. That has been a real solid comp for them this season. It was a comp that they wrecked CJ with.
Four warding totems?
Yeah, four warding totems with this one. Whether they will play it with Kuzan, who tends to be more all-in than GBM, is a bit of a question. Early Cassiopeia, actually, for Nagne, so we talked about that not being a big priority pick, but it is going to come through here.
This is a really weird stat that I pulled, Monte Cristo, and I also think of Kuzan as more of the attempting to be lane dominating, you know, more aggressive of the mid laners, but when it comes to GBM and Kuzan, they are third last and last on percentage team damage in the league, so the mid lane has certainly not been a high source of damage for this team. Honestly, when GBM's playing the likes of his 20 KDA Lulu, they probably look the best there. But when he's playing the high damage threats, it hasn't worked out for them.
Well, they're just a team that, I mean, sure, Chaser can add what he can from the jungle. But
he can have the last pick as well.
Yeah, he's going to get that last pick. Although well, it's probably the Echo, actually.
Probably.
It is the Echo. I don't think Trace is going to be playing top lane Echo in this game.
The dream.
So, but this is another kite composition coming in. Well, they have pretty good engage with the Alistar and the Echo too, but just the way Jhené tends to play team fights is backwards.
So to someday go against his carry nature and just take the Maokai so that the lack of backline threat is palpable, because they have the Sivir, they don't really have good options to lock down the backline. If they take Maokai here, how are they going to deal with this comp?
Yeah, I think you should definitely take the Maokai because it forces Trace onto a different champion. And when he doesn't have Maokai or Rumble, he plays Hecarim or Gnar. Hecarim, he's not actually very good at, honestly. Mm-hmm. He misses a lot of ults. He has a hard time setting it up. And because he's a low economy top lane, it delays the Hecarim power spike because he's never the guy who gets the money to buy the Trinity Force.
The risk I see, I very much like the comp that it looks like KT have assembled. If you plug and play the Victor for the Cassiopeia, we've seen this Victor versus Cassiopeia matchup go horribly wrong for the Cassia, especially if she loses her turret early. And we're expecting high pressure to come out of Chaser because that's just the name of the game from him as a player. He's got good wave clear coming through from the bottom, good wave clear in the mid. Man, this would be a different pick for Trace, but maybe it's necessary.
Well, Trace wasn't always this way, right?
Wasn't he a big Rengar player once upon a time?
He used to be a very hyper-aggressive top laner. There used to be that kill potential for him. And maybe, it's not going to be probably the Rek'Sai. I would be extremely surprised. Trace just having a laugh right there on your screen. And, okay, it's like maybe I was wrong. See the Nidalee flashed over. But honestly, split push Rek'Sai wouldn't actually be that bad in the top lane. It's been a while since we've seen it, but it would fit Trace's playstyle.
They would have exactly zero backline threat with that.
It's true, but he does play it in solo queue.
Well, it's no grouping ever if they do lock in the Rek'Sai. We've seen Samsung Galaxy try to run that comp, but no, they're going to shy away. The Rek'Sai would have been avoid teamfights, take down structures. Nah means the teamfight time.
It is, and for a team that, as I said, likes to kite, this one's all in. You have the Alistar now, you have the Ekko and the Gnar, the huge front line to complement the Victor and the Sivir engage. KT, though, they've got a lot of ways to stop this. Petrifying Gaze, they've got good peel with the Gragas, Maokai, and Thresh. It's going to come down to frontline damage. And fact is, KT is going to have better 5v5 teamfighting late thanks to the Kog'Maw. So, essentially, both of these compositions in the late game are just going to be running at each other, and it's entirely dependent on who kills who's frontline first.
To me, the big irony of Monte Cristo is that KT are running a comp that Jhin'Air are running a comp that KT was kind of monopolizing. They love these Sivir engage comps. That's why we called Arrow Scuttle Crab. It's amazing to see them morph from the all-in, only win with the Sivir Hecarim comps to this peel for the hyper carry, Arrow going completely opposite in terms of AD carry identity from the Sivir to the Kog'Maw.
Yeah, it is interesting. I'm wondering if he's too over-reliant on that because Arrow, probably out of all the AD carries in this league, has the fewest games on Corki, and he just hasn't been able to use that champion at all. And we've seen it, and it hasn't been pretty. But we'll see if he can pull out another win on Kog'Maw. KT looking for their fourth straight best of three win. Let's get into the game. Welcome to Game 1. KT Rolster versus the Jhin'Air Green Wings. Playoff implications galore in this match as Jhin'Air finds themselves currently in 6th place, although they haven't played as many matches as some of the other teams, as Nagne will seduce you.
Slither around.
Are you seduced, Papa Smithy?
Oh, you know, a little bit.
I see how it is.
See how this mid lane matchup goes. Again, Cassiopeia had no luck whatsoever in this same exact matchup. I believe it was SKT versus Ku is when Ku opted into the Cassiopeia, got bossed around by Faker's Victor, and just became a non-factor when her turret went down early. Well, that's probably not going to happen in the same manner here. Of course, Chase is going to find it harder to gank a Victor lane because it doesn't have the instant CC, but there's the possibility, and it feels like if you lose that mid lane pressure, Cassio just can never hold a candle to the instant line wave clear of a Victor.
Yeah, that's a big concern, I agree. And this is one of the reasons why we've seen less Kassadin and Cassiopeia here in Korea, is that the Korean teams are very good at bullying you out of lane, taking your turret, and then Cassiopeia just never actually hits a power spike. You have to have that tier. You have to have the Abyssal Scepter as you build in there, and we see the Ward going down. We're going to see an attempt Death Ray steal here. As there are only two saplings.
Gets one of them, and the second one goes to the poison. Okay, so most of the experience going through to Nagne. I've got good news for you, Monte Cristo. Guess who loves to build a little bit tanky with a Tia, maybe a Rylai's and Eliandre's? It's Cassiopeia, so she's back next.
Hello, Peekaboo. What are you doing here? And that is a level one gank flay. Goodbye, Kuzan. Oh, jeez. That was so brutal. I wasn't even watching for that, Papa Smithy. Peekaboo, you are a dirty, dirty roamer. These are the tricks he used to pull back on Xenix. And just coming into the lane swap, they expected Picaboo to maybe be warding at that brush, but they didn't expect him to just show up with a flay.
It's the oldest trick in the book. Picaboo, I see you.
Oh, didn't see him until late, though. That's the deadliest game of Peekaboo.
And what's the better time than to gank the new mid laner, the young rookie who's just playing one of his first games?
Oh, my.
He'll never fall for that again.
That is actually hilarious. Wow.
Also, what? Really effective.
Yeah. Sometimes you got to go for a little cheese, Pop Smithy.
Picaboo is a master of the cheese.
I mean, they didn't even have to burn a summoner besides exhaust. Kuzan didn't even bother to flash because he knew he was just dead to rights.
He cleansed, I think.
Yeah, he did cleanse, but that was about it. So score now, starting to invade because there's nothing Kuzan can do about this. Chaser going to have to get out of there. He's going to actually, oh, time winds his way out of that. There's a flash. Oh! Oh, geez. Chaser, if he had eaten that hook, he had to flash right there, but there's another summoner spell burn. KT going hard out of the gates here. They're now turning their sights onto Trace, but Che already under that turret. And this is where we saw things go very badly for Catch against Score.
It's Picaboo and Score working so well together. It's a treat to see, because remember, bossing around Catch, okay, Catch not covered himself in glory this season. Chase has been one of the MVPs of this league. He's right up the top five in MVP voting. It's getting bossed around by this new Score Picaboo duo.
Well, what is he supposed to do right there? That was the way he started the jungle pathing, he had to go into that top side to get his second buff just because of how it worked out. And at that time, there was just so much freedom. We also saw the Maokai go down into the bottom side early, and Picaboo's still going aggressive. Hello, Flay.
There's so much information on the top side jungle. Chase level 2 only, still fairly tanky, high health, so won't die. The trade going the advantage. See Chaser pushing into mid, getting some damage on Nagne.
Yeah, Kuzan has no mana though, so they can keep doing this. Kuzan very, very low, does slow Chaser down, and they're going to turn this gank around with some nice twin fangs.
Yeah, they wanted to change target onto Chaser, but just wasn't able to do that. Chaser didn't have flash, so it would have been fairly easy pickings, but body blocking from Kuzan unfortunately ends up in him losing, what, 3 or 4 health potions?
And guess what?
The
Score's
invades
still
are not
here.
Done.
This is just, oh my. Score just having a duel over the wolves. He has to be careful. Victor could get through to this. Chaser losing out. Parallel Convergence is down, but Score's not going to walk in there for the stun. Stuns the wolves with a reset. Meanwhile, Someday is also in the jungle. KT, oh my, this is a very aggressive League of Legends.
And we finally get the answer to the oldest question in the book. Who chases the chaser, Monte Cristo? It's Score.
It is. Well, it's also very safe. What KT is doing. They're just playing so well as a team. And we talk about this early game, that gank in the mid lane, Someday got into lane very early too. So he has a CS advantage and a level advantage because they knew that Chaser was going to be coming up to that top side. He could just walk down there. Alistar had already switched it up.
Still really heartening to see one smart play from Picaboo leading to another smart invade, leading to a nice pressure, and we saw almost complete vision of multiple camps in the top side, meaning that Picaboo could play so aggressive even in the 2v2 lane. Layers upon layers, usually an exciting thing for an analyst to see.
Yeah, exactly. And I didn't expect this KT to come out tonight, Papa, because this looks much more like the KT we saw early in this season. I know when you came to Korea, you were saying, wow, I really like watching KT. They play so smart. And then somehow they sort of lost that along the way somewhere. But this is the kind of play that they were demonstrating towards the end of spring season and the beginning of summer.
I don't know if that's, again, the Picaboo Score synergy that we talked already so much about. But
oh, my geez. Tracer's going to get grabbed and flayed, and they have to knock him back. The Kog'Maw back with the headbutt. Trace, not taking too much damage there.
Siv has been getting solo experience. Captain Jack versus Someday in the bottom lane. So they don't get the 1v1 matchup between Maokai and Gnar, which honestly, that's the advantage for KT. You know, it's a very difficult laning matchup until you can get maybe a Catalyst or a bit of armor built up, maybe a Glacial Shroud. But once you get enough tankiness to shrug off some of the damage, much more manageable for KT.
You know the craziest thing is Picaboo is 2 levels ahead of Che right now.
That's a lot.
I don't even know how he did that.
But it's because every time he went somewhere, something happened. They contested a buff, they got a gank off, etc. His roams, he was always picking up experience, whereas Che's been on the back foot all game.
Yeah, Che's now level 4, but there was a brief period of time where it was 5-3. So where are they going to go now? Chaser just heads back to the enemy red buff. Okay. They think they have him bottled up. This is dangerous
no
from
flash?
Chaser. There's no flash, as you said. Here comes Score. He's going to check it. Chaser has to leave. He can't stay here. He may die anyway. He's going to try and just phase dive over the wall. I'm not sure that's going to actually save him, as there are the Twin Fangs. The lockdown is here. Someday, Arcane smashes him into the ground for another kill. This is all going south for Jhin Air.
And the stats package shows that their top lane narrowly going to lose in terms of CS at 10 or gold at 10. Mid lane also going to be a losing lane. It's usually the jungler that picks up the slack, and it's the jungler that's been targeted out by KT Rollstone.
Well, this game plan early certainly doing a lot of favors for KT. They find themselves up 1.5K at only 8 minutes into the game.
That's many patches ago, many moons ago, that might have been a common occurrence, but with the lack of global gold opportunities, that's just massive, massive bullying by KT Rollstone in 10 minutes.
Yeah. So blue buff will be handed over to Kuzan. And same thing happening on the opposite side of the map. Nogne will grab his blue. Nogne got that very early Negatron cloak, so he's not going to have as many problems in lane getting poked out by the Victor, because he got that first blood, and now he has another assist to help him in terms of his finances.
But the lane control that's offered by your jungler just being so far on top of the enemy jungler, this can't be a Victor that just wave clears and tries to auto-attack the turret and get in the face of the Cassiopeia. Kuzan has to respect the fact that Score is all over Chaser, all over his jungle, all over the mid lane, and he has to expect Score to respond before Chaser, because Chaser's so far behind.
Yep, absolutely. And Score just translating that advantage into a red buff. Very safe take right there. Nobody in the top side. Pink ward down. Clean red buff steal. And now they think that Maokai's gone back, remember. That's what they think right now. So someday just going to wrap around. It's going to be a surprise gank. They're not going to get it off, as they will lead, but they're going to lose a pink ward and the Raptor, as Chaser's jungle is closed in on once again.
Chaser's jungle? Which one's that exactly, Monte Cristo?
Yeah. Does he even have one anymore?
I think he gets a wolf camp once in a while.
Yeah, that is. Well, we're back into standard lanes at the moment. Hex Drinker is first for Trace, so at least he's going to be able to harass in the top side. He didn't fall behind, unlike his teammates, but someday still a kill up.
Yeah, building for team fights rather than for lane. You know, Glacial Shroud would have been probably the more selfish laning choice, but it's going to be building towards the Righteous Glory. Health and Sustain still going to be very useful against the very irritating chip damage harass coming through from Trace on the Gnar.
Okay. Turning to lane now.
Uh-oh.
There's the parallel convergence. It's going to come through, but the phase dive doesn't activate it. Lantern will take him out. Chain misses his pulverize, and here come the TP. Score's already there on the rebound. Arrow has the exhaust down onto him. He's going to have to flash for that, but they do pick up Captain Jack as they target him with the teleport. And Gnar just unable to do anything. Chrono Break not going to save Chaser, but the phase dive will. But the hook over the wall. Pikaboo following it up. Nogne low. Nogne gets a summoner heal. Uses that,
here
they're
going to
keep trying chasing. Here comes another hook, out of the black. Flay over the wall, hook, nope. Just flash from Pikaboo.
Pikaboo decided they were going to win this game and they were going to win it quick, because he has dictated 11 minutes purely off his own back.
Pikaboo has come out so strong since his movement to KT. He's back with his own Zenix lane, his old Zenix lane partner, Arrow. They've worked out the kinks. He's operating so well with Score. But you look at this synergy, and it's hard to point to a better jungle support synergy over the second round robin than these two guys.
In recent performance, I think you have to say, so we're going to see the replay. It looked like it was going to be bad times for Arrow, but
Chain missed
hook.
The pull, too. That's really bad.
Yeah, and then Score comes in. He's over-leveled. He has the items on top of the Echo as well. Maokai means that Captain Jack's the first to go down. And they just don't have the damage to get down Arrow, even though he's down to 400 health at one point in this fight. But a predictive pull.
Look at that Petrifying Gaze, too. If Jhin Air turns away from that, they turn into the rest of the team. So there's no chance to really dodge it out. Then Pikaboo, the patient, flay over the wall. And he just is going to wait right there. I don't know why he flashed.
And then Trace, you could see him frustrated. Remember, he was on 90 Rage most of that fight, could never make anything happen, didn't even transform into Gnar, and watched three members of his team die despite expending his teleport.
We were talking about this before the badge pop in Smithy, but you know, we were kind of expecting KT to win this one coming in. And you said, what'd you say?
I said, the KT are going to dominate Jin Air. Two sub-26-minute wins, instill false hope, and get smashed by SK Telecom. And you know what? It's looking pretty good so far.
You're nailing it, at least in game one.
This game has just been taken away from Jin Air and taken away from Chaser. And this is the guy they rely on. And he's behind in items. He's behind in stats. Levels he's actually caught up on.
Nope.
But he's going for speculative plays.
Well, at this point, I mean, he knew how far behind he was. You can criticize him from going into that red buff and dying and all that other jazz. But at a certain point, you have to at least try to make plays.
Sure.
Because otherwise, you know how the script plays out. If you play it out normally, then what happens is you just die. Because Score and Peekaboo are never leaving your jungle. You'll never get experience. You're going to fall behind. Chaser is going to get bodied here. Exploding Cask. Oops. Hook misses. And Score Lanterns. Oh, man, there's the play. And Chaser gets out with the Chrono Break, but eats a Twin Fang to his demise.
And who stands up when Chaser is basically court-martialed out of this game? I don't think there is anyone on Jin. No. We already discussed Trace. He loses lane in terms of gold, but he doesn't die, but he loses lane well. He does the right thing for a tank top laner. Kuzan and GBM, they don't take over games in carry. It's all about Chaser. And Captain Jack's just new in the lineup.
Well, Captain Jack actually does do a large amount of the damage, but what is he supposed to do in this situation? He can't 1v5 the enemy team when they have a Maokai, when they have a Gragas, ways to disrupt him. And Nagni's going to take away Jin Air's blue, and their own is up right now. I don't see Chaser being able to get back there. The pink ward is still at his red. Peekaboo is just going off.
Has Chaser gotten a red this game? I don't believe so. This might be his first.
I think it is.
So
I think it is.
Yeah, Gragas freshly shopped, so not going to be in position to take it away. The pink ward actually going to give them exact timer, so maybe the next one's going to be a possibility, but Chaser dealing with scraps.
Yeah, and you don't care if Chaser has a red buff when he's 0-3-0.
Nope. You don't care at all.
There's not even a good way to set him up besides the Alistar, really.
I mean, the lanes, it's not... Remember, when we saw Echo and we praised the comp coming through in CJ Enders, think about the lanes we're talking about. We're talking about Twisted Fate Maokai. And Maokai Echo have excellent synergy because, again, targeted route into the Paolo Convergence stun, into death, usually. Speculative to try and gank a Gnar lane, very difficult to coordinate your CCs. The Victor, again, Cassio's not going to sit in the gravity field. Only really bottom lane is a possibility, and the last time he tried that, he died.
Yeah, very bad situation now. It has been all game, but that lead keeps growing and growing and growing. Now up to 4K. Kog'Maw's Trinity Force is done here at 15 minutes. They have some free time down on the enemy tower. Nagne is forcing Victor out of lane. And are they going to get this? Lantern's there. And it'll be taken out. Thresh grabs arrow. Right after the tower kill, Nagne starting to get some nice tower damage of his own. And here comes Score. Oops, Raptor buff runs out. Sad times.
The thing that people need to understand about this game, you need to rewind to Peekaboo, because Peekaboo's the one who won them this game. Getting that gank off at level one opened up the ability to counter jungle, because of course, how can Kuzan react with no cleanse, with underleveled situation after dying at level one? That just basically the flow-on effect of Peekaboo's smart move at level one is what has allowed KT to just completely dominate 16 minutes of this game.
And honestly, you have to wonder with Peekaboo, what happens in a world where Peekaboo isn't injured and he actually plays for SKT, because that is terrifying.
Well, did you see much of him last season? Because of course,
yeah, he played well. He wasn't at this level, that's for sure.
What percentage of playing time was he getting?
Very small, very small.
So maybe they were working him into the lineup, and then, you know, the injury forced their hands in a lot of ways. I know you were skeptical the moment they announced that he'd be coming into this lineup. You're like, but Fix is not bad. Fix is a decent support. What will Peekaboo bring?
Wrong.
We found out what Peekaboo brings.
Well, I didn't know that Peekaboo would immediately transition into a major shot-calling member of this team.
And also, best buddies with jungler Score, and of course, jungle support synergy. We just look back to last Worlds, how important that can be, because their vision level from 3 weeks ago to now, it's upper echelon after being one of their big problems.
Yeah, I totally agree with you. Yeah, Fixer definitely a decent support, and you're right, I didn't see the major upside to that, but there were things that I couldn't have known too, like how well he would get function with Score, and also, like I said, his shot calling abilities. I talked to him, and he told me it was rough for a month, but after that, he and Score really are the shot callers on this team. And so with him bringing that in and seeing the improvement in KT's macro play, it is night and day.
I think it's nice. I'm sure SKT's happy for him because, of course, they have a support who's been performing, and Wolf has been very consistent since kind of a sidestep against Anarchy, and now Peekaboo getting his chance to shine and shining bright.
Yeah, for sure. Well, Trace is doing some good chip damage to this top lane turret, and they are going to take it. Chaser's here on the flank. Someday in a bit of trouble. Has to flash out of the parallel convergence. Can they actually get him, though? Gotta get the stun. Gotta get the Chilling Smite into the wall. So Someday in a bit of trouble right now. He's just going to Arcane Smash. Wow, he's just too tanky. They can't kill him. There's no damage.
No items on Chaser. It's only an Alistar to help for damage. Only really provides CC. And at the same time, they're going to lose Dragon and potentially a couple of kills.
Yeah, we'll see. Someday can come in with the TP if he needs to. Victor's here, but they're not going to go for it. But in the end, what does Jhin Air get? They can't even take out the turret.
Well, I mean, what did KT get? They get the dragon, they chase out in top, and hey, they're going to get the mid turret probably too.
Yeah, that is... Oh boy. I mean, you got to go for something if you're Jhin Air, right? Try for a gank onto the Maokai. Unfortunately, they didn't have Captain Jack or Kuzan there to actually finish it off, and here comes Arrow.
He's scared.
You shouldn't be scared. There's no gravity field right now.
Well, that's gold not in the pocket.
Peekaboo's going to go up and auto it like a boss.
He's thinking about it.
I guess they'll just have to wait for one more wave. He definitely could have just walked up.
So we felt really good about Jhin Air about a month and a half ago. Feeling pretty good about KT right now.
Well, the meta's changed, right?
Sure.
That's one of the things we have to talk about is when Jhin Air is at a point in the meta where they don't have to have that much invested in their top lane, they come out strong. We think about when Jhin Air was strong in spring and earlier this season, they were playing a lot of poke compositions. What their specialty is kiting at objectives, and they pulled it off, but that isn't such a viable strategy. Or it's still viable, but it's no longer as dominant as it was.
I think you throw in Nidalee. This comp could have worked, but Nidalee was available. That's the crazy thing, is that Nidalee's been almost a perma-ban given their proficiency with the poke comp and not selected.
I'm with you on that, Papa Smithy, but I think if Jhin Air can't play this composition that they've been given, there's something very wrong with the team.
But can you say they can't play it, given that this game turned at level one?
That's true. Yeah, this game was all about the jungle invades, and Jhin Air hasn't had any kind of breathing room.
Can Jhin Air win a game where Chaser does poorly? I think the answer is no.
I tend to agree with you.
If you have lanes that lose the minimum, then it should be your jungler that profits from that, whether it comes to communication or positioning. But if your lanes lose the minimum and your jungle falls behind, there's no one to carry.
Scorr just stole the Krugs. What a jerk. He had the burst too from his keg and the smite. It's not really a chance for Chaser to take that.
I mean, at this point, 6,000 gold lead almost, 5,500, I believe. How's my math looking? About 5,500 gold lead. Looking for the last of the outer turrets. Captain Jack has excellent wave here, though, so it'll take a couple of, or maybe it won't. Maybe they'll just pick a boost, go take it. Easy peasy.
Yep, have the lantern there just in case. Head back out right now.
Still not sure which one is Chaser's jump.
Well, KT decided that he didn't get to have a jungle this game, unfortunately for him. But I praised KT's ability to snowball against Spenu when we saw that and how dominant Scorr was. They did drop the ball in the second game, but KT is a team that at these days, if you give them this much control early, they know how to run with it and punish you to the maximum possible degree.
And maybe we should temper our excitement because SK Telecom will not give them this early game.
Yeah, that's true.
But Peekaboo, I mean, he did something no one would have expected. He did something that you see maybe once in a while in solo queue, maybe in a scrim, but in a competitive game, just hanging out of vision and getting the level one kill one in this game. So the next game, probably not going to be such the level shenanigans. Can KT shine so bright two games in a row?
Well, it was such a foresight for him to do that, too, because there have to be specific conditions that are met, right? You have to have the lane swap. You have to ward their buff and realize that they're not on that side of the jungle so you can pull it off, and then you just go for the surprise play, because usually these days, it's just playing with the meta, right? Because the standard lane swap in Korea is somebody freezes, the AD carry will freeze, and the support will try and roam and disrupt the jungle pattern. So if you're jungling on your strong side, well, then Peekaboo can make a play like that onto your mid lane. If you're jungling on your weak side, well, then it's pretty standard and expected. So he's kind of taken it one step further down the line.
And the opportunity cost was so low. Like, there was nothing that they, if the gank hadn't come off, he would just walk to lane. They would have lost nothing out of it. Just because, as you mentioned, Jhin Air were playing the standard playbook, and KT threw it out, did something different, and profited to the degree that it snowballed a 6,000 gold advantage.
Yeah, he didn't even have to get the first blood there. Like you're saying, if he gets a summoner out, even if he just gets damage out, Nagne is in a much better position.
I mean, the only thing I'll say is that because they got the kill, by the time Victor came back to land, they were contesting a buff, and he was so far behind in experience that he kind of had to pick up the minions. So even though he had the shortest distance to contest the jungle invade, he couldn't. So it really, really helped in that particular regard. Jhin Air trying to get their turret finally, but multiple members from KT and a quick Peekaboo coming.
Yeah, Peekaboo, I use that, but gets it spell shielded. Quite obvious. The telegraphed death sentence, but the dragon up in 40 seconds. And
two turrets, though. That's some global gold.
Yep. Trace did a very good job of just methodically picking away at that objective. He's going for a fastball of Malmortius. So, interestingly, Jhin Air's answer to this is going to be split push with Gnar, which is actually smart because that's about the only thing they can do.
It probably will be the more now that I think about it. Of course, Frozen Mallet does build out of the pickaxe, but just given the itemization required against the team, Maw is probably the most immediate power spot.
Yeah, and also a way that they could at least have pressure onto one lane with this Maokai, who hasn't been building. I mean, he's getting a Frozen Heart now, but there it is. Okay, well, it's done. That does make things harder.
Considerably. So there's been no kills whatsoever for Jhin Air this game. 24 minutes in again. Another low kill game, but it's because KT have just been completely on top of this game from moment one. That's the teleport.
Uh-oh. Chaser in front. There's the Silverold pop. He's going to get onto Captain Jack, but it is spell shielded. Still the Arcane Smash ripping people out. There's the parallel convergence. Does get someday, but he gets out of the lantern all the same. So attempted an engage, but no one actually dies as Jhin Air able to play that defensively. They also get the angle onto the turret. So can KT, looks like they just want to come in from behind. They're going to all in right here. And here comes the Petrifying Gaze. Huge Petrifying Gaze from the Flash. And now Trace on the outside. Kuzan going to get hooked somehow. And here comes Arrow just waddling through the team fight, picking up kills. Trace is going to be caught up by Someday and Peekaboo again. The CC train is just never ending. Another hook. And here we go. Twisted Advance play. The works and Peekaboo grabs the kill. What a beautiful engage from Nagne with the Flash Petrifying Gaze, and that's going to be a Baron.
I mean, they've got the Blade of the Ruin King on Kog'Maw already. Nagne has so much damage. Okay, doesn't have a lot of mana, but it's not going to matter. There's no need to peel off and fight anyone because everyone's dead. 10-0 is the score. Not a perfect game because turrets have come down, but everything else, man, what a KT performance.
Jeez. Utterly dominant. And this Jhin Air team is the one, they've come the closest to beating SKT out of the top six teams in a game. They had an inhibitor down on SKT. Let's take a look at this one again.
So it was a nice idea from Jhin Air, given how far behind they were, but the Petrifying Gaze registered on, including Captain Jack, which is probably just a mechanical mistake. Not sure how Kuzan got hooked, but after this, just watch. You can see Peekaboo chasing away the only threat to Kog'Maw, and Kog'Maw free-autoing.
This is why we see this Thresh banned against Peekaboo, because the work he does in these team fights is incredible. And Peekaboo takes the last kill. Jack, the only one left alive. And here comes the pressure. Jhin Air already having to retreat off their mid lane tier 2.
I think Kog'Maw, fast approaching ban status, he has the highest win rate of any champion with over 10 picks. And while you might be skeptical, no one's willing to play these backline dominant champions barring the Maokai. If you don't get the Maokai, there's just no way to deal with them. How many team fights in consecutive games have we seen where a Kog'Maw waddles along, no pressure on him whatsoever, yep, free autoing?
Yeah, there was no threat on the Arrow. He was just in the middle of the composition too.
He's the highest damage AD carry with the long range, and no one whatsoever forcing him to back away.
Well, here we go. Another minion wave. Another tier 2 inhibitor down now in the mid lane. KT pressing forward. Well, Papa, it's going to be 27 minutes at least. I'm sorry.
Well, my heart was in the right place, apparently.
And going to keep on going, it would seem. Gravity field down, but Arrow We'll take that tower down by about a quarter. Still working on it.
The wave clear is very good from Janem. It doesn't really matter so much when we're talking about 10,000 gold advantage. Cannon minion keeps bashing away. Anyone who tanks for arrow is going to lead to, you know, at least a fifth of the turret damage coming down. He's happy to tank it up himself. Eventually, this turret will fall for Janem Greenwings.
Yep. So they get the position. Tanks in the front. Saplings down for the slow. And just dodging away from that death ray. Arrow just takes the lantern out. Peekaboo already prepped for the retreat. And that is two easy inhibitors off of a great Baron push from KT Rolster.
That's the only place where Chaser is satisfied about this game is there's been no kills for him to participate in, so his overall statistic hasn't changed. Sometimes you have
That's
to think
so
about
true.
Number one, Monte Cristo. You know what I'm saying?
Chaser's kill contribution. It's like, I just got to hold out for the rest of the season.
Yep.
Damn. Oh.
There's nothing else, I mean, Chaser especially, nothing else he can be selfishly or team happy about. I mean, it's not his fault. Other problems snowballed. Basically, Kuzan's mistake, or Peekaboo's individual brilliance, spilled over into Jhin'ah's jungle, and Scorp bodied in the whole game.
Yeah, and this is something that we've seen from SK Telecom, too, is that you give them that one first blood or something like that, and there's virtually no hope of coming back into the game. And there certainly hasn't been for Jhin'ah. This is how you play League of Legends with an incredible snowball.
Yeah, they threw the textbook out for level one, but certainly textbook once they had this big advantage. They've already got an inhibitor in bottom, in top lane, so the bottom one's the fast to get. They're going to maybe try a desperate engage.
No, but Nogde is just taken out with the lantern, and they've got nothing left. Scorsell on the side, they're just going to power on through this turret. There's the box, catches Kuzan, another hook onto Che, gets another kill for Arrow, and they keep on moving forward. Jack will fall in the end. Double kill for Arrow, and they say, screw this inhibitor, we're just going straight for the Nexus. That's going to be it, a sub 30-minute victory for KT Rolster as they absolutely blast the Jhin'ah Greenwings in game one of this series.
Lucky number 13 for KT Rolster, 13-0, 3-0 in Dragons. Okay, all tied up in turrets for part of that game, but in the end, KT Rolster, off the back of some Peekaboo brilliance, blow Jhin'ah away.
Peekaboo is so good. Holy cow. I don't know if you can let him have Thresh. He just is too much of a playmaker on that champion. He can ruin your entire team. He plays so well in those team fights. Well, that's a tough loss. I wonder if we'll see GBM next game. Of course, Kuzan's penchant for pushing forward was part of that first blood, for sure. He played aggressively. He tried to get those Raptors and then kept playing forward, so.
KT had the scouting report, put him to the sword, and now we're going to see in game two whether
there are different reasons for Nocturne.
You
could just kill him instantly, so.
There's that. But in the mid lane, Chawi showed. The Yomu's Ghost Blade, full damage, kill all the people. That will kill Kog'Maw fast. So we're waiting for the Nocturne counterpick to Kog'Maw in this draft.
All right. We'll see how it goes for them. Okay, looks like they want to take Maokai if they're going to ban the Fizz against Someday.
That's a lot of respect to Peekaboo. Necessary after what they felt in game one. That would have been insisted whichever lineup they went to. So Thresh banned as the first ban.
The problem is if you ban the Fizz, that means that you must first pick Maokai because you can't give Maokai up to KT because they're even more free to pick it up now. And what does that mean? If Alistar is available, Peekaboo is a really good Alistar player too. And you give him another champion that he can engage with and make plays with. They banned the Azir against the Nogne for the second game in a row and Ryze. So if they don't pick Maokai, they've screwed up. They're going to pick Victor, I guess. GBM's a good Victor player, but do you really want to give Someday that Maokai again?
You just lock in Maokai, Alistar, and laugh, I think,
yep.
If you're KT.
Absolutely, 100%. You don't care about this at all.
Maokai, Kog'Maw, also fine.
That's true. Jhin'ah will take the Kog'Maw in the second round of the draft. Peekaboo's played a little Braum, played a little Janna so far. Some games Peekaboo has been off. You and I talked about
Absolutely.
That Spenu series. He wasn't playing his best. So he certainly hasn't been consistently at that level we saw him in the last game.
I think it's unfair to kind of ask him to be consistent after he's coming off from an injury layoff, after he's coming off just not getting a lot of game time. Has his off games, and that's understandable.
Now, KT has prioritized this Echo for score. He is the best jungle Echo we have seen so far. He plays around the parallel convergence very well in the front line. but maybe just reverting to a Rek'Sai.
He's pretty damn good at the Rek'Sai, too.
Yeah, he certainly is. So what is Wing going to bring to this team? You have to imagine that Chaser does a lot of that shot calling. And I mean, why ban Fizz if you're just going to give up the Maokai? That's my main question.
I mean, you have a plan. That's the only reason I can see for it. You need something else. What is your pocket pick to deal with this? Is it maybe a Shen? Is it Shen time? Just go for a different type of top lane tank to kind of just have a farm lane against the Maokai and cause headaches in the late game. Rek'Sai already gives you another quasi-global to answer it, but yeah, if you're just going to give up Maokai and you don't have the, you know, kill lane threat of Fizz, it just feels like a poor draft.
Just a waste of ban. There's no problem with letting your opponent have Maokai. Obviously, he's a strong pick, but why waste a very crucial ban against that pick? Like you said, it could be a Shen, but even so, you're... I don't know about this.
Trace hasn't played Shen.
I'm waiting to see how it plays out, Papa Smithy.
Okay.
Calm it down. All right. Okay, Alistar probably will be taken, and they're going to grab the Echo once again. Actually, Janna. So it looks like it's kite time for Jhenair. They're going to play a kite Victor comp this time instead of an engage Victor comp.
The Nidalee looms is a great pick. If Chaser was in the lineup, don't know if Winged has really been defaulting towards the Nidalee, but does loom as a threat with the champions that have already been selected. KT showed nothing in their first round, so where do they want to go with this draft?
Kog'Maw. There's no threat. Where's the primary engage coming from?
Echo.
No. It's not Echo, it's not Janna. Wow, why would you take Sivir here? Okay, there's Annie. So you have some engage on this. Maybe they just want Sivir so that Jhenair can't kite as effectively, because they do like to run Sivir and Victor in kite composition.
You know when you close your eyes and you're smelling, you're like, what does that smell like? It smells like a kite comp. Maybe it's time to go Sivir Annie and suss it out before it even comes to be.
That's true. And they also have the Maokai already, so they're not short on methods of engagement onto Jhenair.
It just seems like they're calling the bluff. They're saying, okay, looks like kite comp. I see the Janna. You know, it's the queen of disengage.
I don't know why you would take the Janna this early. It gives away too much.
I mean, they first picked their mid laners. They were already volunteering important information over on the blue side. So, yeah, we'll have to see where Jhenair goes, because now do you risk some sort of immobile mid, immobile top laner, or, I mean, a very aggressive, like, snowball jungler like Nidalee? It doesn't seem like it's really realistic. Of course, they have the Echo already, so it's probably going to be the jungle pick.
Rumble should be the pick in the top side if we don't trace. Will aid with the kiting, so Pilot probably going back onto the Corki, you'd imagine. Now, I suppose they could take Gnar, but that doesn't really help them with their kiting that well.
It's not kiting anymore, really. They've got some good turret poke, I guess. You know, throw down the Victor Gravity Field and try and use those Trinity Force Corki auto attacks to take down structures, but still not a really cogent identity that Janna really adds to.
No, definitely not. And you also have to worry very much about a kill lane from Sivir and Annie. Of course, you have the Monsoon by the time that Annie hits 6, but if Rek'Sai is there, that could be a quick death for Pilot and Che, and they're just going to lock it in, so the Gnar will be the selection. I'm really surprised that the Gnar is taking priority over the Rumble in this particular game. Of course, maybe they want that winning matchup in topside. They want to have that Gnar pressure. To Trace's credit, he did all he could in that topside last game. He harassed Maokai. He chipped the tower down. He got the tower down in the topside by himself.
I was going to say, Trace played his role perfectly. I mean, the team fight didn't come together, but the team was so far behind that there was really no options. We saw him show up at fights with 90 Rage and then just have to kind of saunter away with nothing he could do. So that was the least of their problems last game. So let him pick it again. Wait to see where KT goes with their mid laner. Nagne, of course, a noted Cassio player. I believe undefeated on this champion this season. Guess it wouldn't be too much of a surprise.
Yeah, I'm surprised that they want to opt into this matchup again, because Cassiopeia isn't going to probably have that same advantage, but who knows? The Annie's up for Peekaboo. He could still make a very similar play to the one he made in game one, but considering that GBM is going to be wise to his tricks, that probably is not going to pan out. They're still going to lock the Cassie in.
But what does Echo do without reliable CC in any lane? Farm?
How do they engage? They can't. There's no primary engage besides a flash Gnar ult.
They take all the turrets and then get a flank with Gnar?
It's not a good comp from Jhenair. Sure, it's not unwinnable, but they have to rely on huge flash plays out of Trace, really, to set up the kind of crowd control that they need to succeed. Meanwhile, KT has a million and one ways to engage on them.
Yeah, Jinhae gives up a couple of dragons, don't even have that to kite back to. Feels like KT's going to run them over again.
Yeah, it really does. I mean, the best thing you can say about Gnar is I guess he can Gnar people away during a kite, but like that is not an efficient use of Gnar as a champion.
No.
Sure, he can do that, but you're going to be much better off with a Rumble who has higher damage while you kite and can really open things up and split the enemy team apart with an Equalizer. So, questionable picks. Also, pretty much only magic damage coming out of Jhin'Air, so easy itemization for KT Rollster. Looking not so great for the Green Wings here in our second game of the evening. Maybe they can pull it off. Like you said, Papa, if they start to get some dragons.
That's all they got.
All right, well, we'll see if they can do it. Jhin'Air versus KT, game number two right now. So, Jhin'Air versus KT, game number two. KT coming off a very strong victory, taking many of the same champions that they had in the last one. Jhin'Air with a triple substitution. Will it work out for them? Can GBM, Winged, and Pilot take them into a third game in this series?
And remember, earlier series, triple substitution came up trumps for CJ, but there's a difference between subbing in the likes of Winged, GBM, and Pilot compared to basically bringing in the A squad like CJ Enzis did with the likes of Shy, Mad Life, and Ambition.
Yeah, definitely. Ooh, nice painting of Arrow there. It's a good one. It's a good painting. Paint Arrow in the MVP interview area.
It's been there a lot. Pentakills aplenty.
He just shakes the Corsair sign, though, when he has the the pentakills.
And
we don't actually get to talk to him.
And after spending so much time shedding that Scuttlecrab image, he's back.
KT doesn't need more than two different AD carries.
No.
They get enough support bans to actually mean that Arrow can play whatever high-priority AD he wants. That's kind of the crazy thing.
It's a weird, wonderful world for KT when they're drawing multiple support bans.
Yeah, very helpful. But also, if you think about it, taking the Thresh away, but they still leave up Annie, which is a ban for most teams in most games. We are going to see the lane swap. This time, Jhin'Air starting on the weak side, so they have to deal with an Annie at the blue buff.
KT get the lanes they want. Remember, they're opting out of the tough early Gnar versus Maokai 1v1 matchup, so they're happy to opt into the lane swap and just allow it to swap back when somebody picks up a Catalyst or works towards the Righteous going for a bit of sustained peekaboo. GBM wise to the ways of peekaboo.
GBM is a smart player. Definitely not going to try and take the same kind of risks that Kuzan would.
Still not a high damage mid laner. Still, again, at least based on statistics, more of a supportive mid laner. To me, it's kind of trademark champion outside the Xerath for ironic reasons is the Lulu that I think they play really well with. They played a really good Jugger Sivir to take out a game off Pooh early in the season, but who's going to carry for this Jhin'Air lineup? I guess with three new members, it's kind of a whole new ballgame.
You know, I'm kind of surprised that Jhin'Air hasn't returned to at least one or two games of mid lane Lulu because it's not as good as it was, it's true, but it's still strong.
And a 3-0 on it.
Yeah.
I really do like the Lulu. I feel like GBM is really good. Of course, we all remember last split, the game where he famously got over 1,000 ability power on the Lulu. They run it and they play around it very smartly, but Q in the rack for Lulu recently.
Yeah. Not too much help there. Well, we do have Jay not going to be delayed in terms of his recall. Actually does manage to pull it off, so he will get into the top side. And you were talking about the lane swap. Well, Arrow and Peekaboo probably would like to get into the Corki and Janna lane early, but it's not going to be the end of the world if they don't get there. And they're also just going to be happy to go at 6 because they do have that kill pressure. You can really see that we just saw on our screen the damage per minute numbers. 575 for Nogne versus only 500. That is very low for a mid laner from GBM. But he does have a great KDA. He never dies, so...
But he never dies, and they lose games when he never dies. It's Xerath famously never dying but still losing.
Yeah, that is an excellent point.
And, I mean, I agree with you on the Sivani front. Of course, Sivani really like to opt into the Corki matchup pre-6 when it's so predictable when you're using the Spell Shield to Spell Shield, the slow-moving Phosphorus Bomb. But if you compare kind of the mismatches, definitely navigating Maokai away from Gnar, higher priority than getting the 2v2.
Yeah, I totally agree with you there. So, going for this, though, Che has to use the Eye of the Storm on himself to block the Boomerang Blade damage. And a little bit of roaming right now from Someday into the river. He does actually, he's putting down wards and taking Scuttle Crab. He's doing some weird stuff while he actually waits for this wave to push up closer to his tower.
So you know what is the most disappointing thing, Monte Cristo? Triple substitution. Where is my sweet bard? Where is my sweet? Where has he gone?
That's so true. We could have seen it. It was banned so much in the early season. Actually, it's one of the most banned champions against Jhin'Air, surprisingly. But we've never actually gotten to see it.
Reminds me of those wrestling angles where the question is, for many weeks, what's in the briefcase? And then no one remembers to show what's in the briefcase. We need to know what the sweet bard is. What is it about this pick?
And honestly, if you're Jhin'Air, why not just pull it out of the box at some point or other?
It's staying in the briefcase. They put the briefcase out the window. It's gone, Monte Cristo. No sweet bard.
Damn it. If you're having trouble, you might as well try mixing it up. And sure, we haven't seen Bard in a while. We mysteriously saw a Bard banned in the last series.
I think he has a very high win rate. Samsung, I believe, a 1-1.
CJ.
CJ 2-0.
Yeah, so, but I mean, very small sample size.
We were so excited to see how Bard would warp the meta.
All right, here comes Wing. He's on top of Arrow already with that phase dive. They're trying to zone him out with parallel convergence. Here comes the teleport from the Maokai. Winged is in a world of trouble right now. Someday's just going to get the W down and smash him into the ground, and he actually gets the kill. Che is going to just barely live. That was a weird positioning for the parallel convergence. Really not surprising peekaboo at all.
But how
and Someday just fast on the trigger with the TP.
But how smart is Score? Just to navigate bottom. They don't even lose any CS. Score picks up the CS in the bottom lane after
they're
the teleport comes through.
Diving now. Look at this. Trace maybe a little bit too far out. Arrow doesn't have the means to catch up. Chooses not to flash for that with the hop. And now going to get some damage down. They can't quite kill. Ooh. That's one hit.
I was just saying, that's how I know K-Tier in form, is they don't even lose resources with this move. They teleport to top, still get the resources over to Score, so he's going to be very fast, turbo level 6 almost, for even more jungle pressure. KT, on form.
Yeah, Someday also ends up with a CS and a level lead. You can see Score gets a ridiculous amount of farm for holding that wave, and there's really nothing Corki can do about it with just a Doran's Blade, because Rek'Sai can just go and heal if you get any harass with the passive. So, very nice play from KT. Jhin'Air already falling behind that first blood. Goes over to Peekaboo, so it's not the biggest threat, but the poise in which KT turned that around and reacted was impressive to see.
Yeah, very assertive teleport, channeling through to get the answering kill through from Someday. Sivir picks up the BF sword. We're going to finally see the 1v1 matchup, but look at the item difference between the Gnar and the Maokai. It's just a null magic mantle against a second Doran's and a Ruby Crystal. There's no extra harassment available for Trace whatsoever, and the levels, that's a lot of level disadvantage.
Yeah, and he's not going to be able to have that same presence with the chip because he has to go back to actually, like you're saying, get that Hex Drinker before he can push the lane at this stage. He cannot afford to trade with Someday without that item.
Yeah, 25 AD, very relevant when we're talking about turret damage given the ranged auto attack from Gnar. So.
And the training damage too.
Absolutely.
Yeah, just he has to be able to actually out-damage the opposition, and even with the Null Magic Mantle, KT's Someday going to be stronger, especially since he does have some additional damage off of those Doran's Rings.
And this is kind of an obscure thing, but of course, when you go the Hex Drinker, the notable thing about Gnar is it does a lot of magic damage, of course, from the Hyper procs as you get more and more levels. If he doesn't have to itemize armor at all, Someday can just go straight into magic resist. It's going to deal with the Hyper proc, but if he can build for the triple AP threat of Winged, GBM, and Pilot and get away with some health and magic resist, you know, Trace needs to be pressuring with physical damage, so the Hex Drinker needs to come pronto.
That's a great point. Great point. So, Arrow behind in lane, though. Pilot left alone. Of course, Corki, one of those nice AD carries to get ahead in terms of levels. So Arrow's still going to be having some issues in this lane for the foreseeable future unless they actually go all in
which is always palpable when we're talking about Peekaboo on Annie.
Yeah.
No flash, so maybe a minute and a half of safety, but...
Now, this is very curious to me, Papa Smithy. We haven't seen any action in the mid lane, but Nagne actually winning this matchup all the same. This is not something that we've seen. I mean, we saw Faker absolutely destroy Kuro in this matchup. But I mean, Nagne coming out with an advantage is interesting to me.
It's always a bit risky to kind of judge a victor lane when the majority of the first minutes, you know, 6-7 minutes, was out without the augment E, without upgrading the E. You don't have instant wave, you can't pressure as hard. So this is the sort of matchup where you look at a victor and be like, why are they even in CS or 10 CS down? And then you check in 10 minutes and they'll be 30 up just because of the nature of how much immediate power you get from the Aftershock augment.
It's also worth noting that the mid turret has already been chunked by 1/3 too. So he has been doing some work in terms of just getting the necessary chip damage. So you're right, Papa. Looking much more similar now, especially that the CS has caught up.
Honestly,
that
just
last wave.
Attacking the power of the first level augment, I think, is important because it gives 150 mana, so you can be a bit more offensive and a bit more liberal with your spells. And just the fact that you can instant clear the backline with, you know, almost no AP from runes at level 7 with just an E, it's so much immediate power. Speaking of power,
GBM gets the flash on Burrow, gravity field down, but he's going to die to the poison. And that'll be it. Winged and Che are there, but they are just a hair too late. Chaos Storm, sadly, swirling over absolutely nothing in the end of that gank. Peekaboo there just in case there's a chance of a re-engage, and look at that. They get a kill, and look at this timing. Immediate deep wards. They have total control. Zero risk from KT Rolster after that gank.
A lot of wards around the dragon defensively from Jhin Air, but I have to feel like after a shopping trip comes through, they'll start to power through that objective in the top lane. Sunday still winning in CS. No, been no more shops, and Trace hasn't felt confident enough to back, hasn't found a back timing. Just giving Sunday a free lane to build Righteous Glory and win team fights.
Wow. Well, Jhin Air really needs to come up with something special to get back into this one, because as we were saying, in the champ select, if they don't start to snowball off of Dragon, if they don't get that positioning, what happens here? They need to either siege with this Corki when he gets the Trinity Force and the Victor. But even then, that looking less and less likely.
That's why the Sivir Annie was such a master. We wanted to see the Kog'Maw because Kog'Maw's done so much winning, but you see the Janna and you're like, ah, I see poke comp. Sivir Annie, no more poking really potential, just because the backline threat, if you ever start trying to set up that poke, okay, you put down the gravity field, you're ready to just get those Corki auto attacks off, Maokai flanks, Annie flanks, just Annie flash tippers from the front. Even the Cassiopeia has been doing work. So much risk.
No, just a Q. I got excited. Arrow couldn't be there in time. Peekaboo was hoping he could wait just a little bit longer for that. Someday had his TP up, but they didn't have a ward in that brush. It could have been actually quite hilarious, but...
His name has been very apt this series. Not a very deadly game of Peekaboo being played by KT.
Well, not so deadly right now, but they are going to get some wards in. They will be seen going into that tri-brush. Nagne dodging out some death rays, like you do in the mid lane in this matchup.
At this point, do you even build a Hex Drinker if you're Trace? Because you're just missing really big windows to harass down the Maokai and chip him away. Like, it's just not happening. And has a lot of gold in the bank. I think maybe you have to opt in those team fights.
Scores here, but Nagne coming up from behind. GBM late. There is Che. There is Peekaboo. Peekaboo has the Tibbers loaded and waiting.
Maokai solo killed Gnar.
What?
Maokai solo killed Gnar.
Okay.
That's why I was like,
I was busy watching the gank unfold in the jungle, Papa Smithy. So both of, okay, so Trace goes in, he doesn't get the stun.
And then you just watch this through, just auto attacks. Gnar only has a null magic mantle, no other combat stats at all, and gets pounded. Gets pounded. And
yep,
that's what KT's been doing all series. And look, he's even given up on the Hex Drinker dream. It's just building towards a Banshee Veil, as far as you can see. Maybe a Spirit Visage, but yeah, if you're 30 CS behind as a Gnar against Maokai, that was one of the trump lanes for Jhin Air.
I'm just so surprised by Jhin Air. I mean, I brought this up before, but they nearly won a game against SKT. They played really, really well. They took an early Baron. They took an early Inhibitor, and it was like a miracle turnaround from a Faker pick that actually got them back into that game.
And let's even go further back in that series. They got pounded in game one, picked themselves up, and had a super competitive game two.
But they also picked Rengar in game one. That was one of those weird games with Jhin Air where you're like, why are you picking non-meta stuff when you're actually good at meta stuff?
But even that notwithstanding, losing against SKT in demoralizing fashion, then driving them right to the edge. Whereas in this series, playing their strongest lineup, losing, rolling over and dying, whether that's in their roster changes, but just in their play style, this is not a team that's really trying to push KT at all.
No. Not in the least, and Winged has... hasn't had that same pressure from Score this game, but look at that CS differential. Part of that, of course, was Score getting so much lane farm early on the teleport from Sunday, but just the coordination surrounding this KT unit has made Winged kind of a non-factor. They keep invading his jungle. He can't do anything without being seen, but I really have to question subbing out Chaser, because it really wasn't Chaser's fault that that problem happened in game number one.
I just don't know.
Maybe Chaser was on tilt or something. I don't know what happened after the game. Maybe he was a little too emotional. He looked pretty mad after game one, that was for sure.
Just given the Jhin Air lineup, just given everything we've built up during the 13-14 series so far this season, subbing out Chaser doesn't sound like the tonic to solve any problem for the Jhin Air Greenwood.
No, he's been the best performing player on the team.
By far.
Yeah.
GBM's had his moments, but has been in and out of the lineup. Captain Jack, same story. In fact, rotating doors for the carries has only really been Trace and Chaser that have kind of been there the whole time.
Well, I can't say that I blame them. You know, if I'm looking at Jhin Air as we see Score take a dragon that will be seen, but Winged having some poison problems as he makes his way over there. Peekaboo is there. I mean, if Quick comes in here, he's just going to die. So they're going to try and pull it out of the pit.
This is the first dragon in the game, so once again, a late dragon, 15 minutes.
Yeah, he's not going to get that. Death Ray attempted steal, but the smite wins in the end.
Uh-oh.
Yeah, you can't walk through there right now. Spitting some poison. So as I was saying, I mean, here's where you're at with Jhin Air, though, right?
Mm-hmm.
You really don't actually want to sub out Trace, right? Because Trace is so good at what Trace does, he's actually a valuable asset.
Sure.
Having a top laner who can play in such a low economy is a boon if you have playmakers in your bottom or your mid lanes. So when Jhin Air has these other players, they're looking for one of them to really step up into that carry role. But it's just not there, right? It's just not happening.
It's just clear in the numbers. The statistics show you. Third last and last in terms of team percentage damage. They're not getting damage out of the mid lane. Captain Jack and Pilot are somewhere in the middle, but they just don't have threats.
Well, and that's it. It just, Jhin Air looks like a team that has good players that just can't, they're not good together. This combination of players on this team doesn't produce a good team. I've said it before, but you know who could really use GBM is Najin. Because he's the guy, when they want just a passive mid laner with a big champion pool to get through the laning phase and consistently, and there we go. There's the any gank going down. Goodbye, Che. Arrow will snag the kill with the help. He doesn't even have to ult for that, just gets an auto in.
Yeah, OQ and GBM sounds like a lovely duo.
Right, and Duke too, right? Then you have a jungler who could just prioritize on ganking the side lanes and just, whatever, GBM, do your thing. And Nagne flashes out. No chance on that. Winged expending his flash to try and get the phase dive stun into the parallel convergence. Gonna be a miss. Nagne, fast fingers.
And I can kind of understand the revolving door of the AD carry role, just because Captain Jack's not your answer in 2016. He's not your answer in 2017. It feels like he's not necessarily playing on borrowed time. He's actually played very well this season, but there's a lot of growth. There's a lot of potential in Pilot. It just feels like the balancing act for Jhin Air in a lot of ways has been off, especially in the last month or so.
Well, and when we talk about Pilot too, obviously the comparison that's made most frequently is to Deft, because he has had those shining moments on some of the caster AD carries, but you know that Samsung Blue didn't hit their peak. What was the change that they made? They put in Dade. You have a low economy top, some guy who's smart at playing the top lane, super consistent, super reliable in Acorn. And the change they made was they brought in a big-time carry mid into that roster.
And it's still the greatest roster change of all time.
Yeah, and I'd love to see GBM and Goong just swap teams right now, because I think that would actually be very interesting.
I'd love to see Dade on this team.
Yeah. For sure.
not all the parts there. And Samsung Blue, you could see they were close to something great even when they had Pawn, but Dade was the big push that really put them over the edge. Feels like Jinan, the offseason, maybe have some work to do.
Yeah, there's definitely some changes that could be made, especially on Jinan and Najin if they decided, uh-oh, here we go, Trace caught out, there's the knock-up from the Rek'Sai. Yep, looks like a little bit of an overlap in the stun there, so they don't actually get the kill. But
have a lot of turret damage, you have to back away, so okay.
Trace in that Mega Nar form is going to be a little bit more problematic. Actually, Score taking a turret hit right there. They have to be super careful with GBM on the flank about how do they play that, but Nagne convinces GBM he doesn't want to go in. Someday just standing there, they're going to try and take away the blue buff. Nice denial. Worth noting that KT is still on their way to the perfect game. 20 minutes into this one, no kills, no towers, no dragons for Jinair.
You want something scarier? Coming into the 20-minute mark, Jinair hasn't got a kill this series.
Wow. That is frighteningly true.
That's not even true of Spenu. Even Spenu haven't had that kind of false glory levied against them, so lots to be worried about.
Pilot is primed, but they're going to come in. There's the Void Rush into the bottom side of the map. Pilot has to tangle with Someday. Is there going to be follow-up? Looks like no. Someday doesn't want to follow that up. They have wards in the enemy jungle. Score gets out on his tunnel. No problem. Winged is able to do nothing.
Jinna haven't got those dragons we talked about. Okay, only one gone down so far this game, but that was the only realistic win condition because you look down the lineup. Gnar into the wall sounds lovely, but how does that happen? They don't have the CC to really force anything.
No, there's no setup with this comp. It's very problematic. And, oh, are they going to get a turret?
Are they going to get a kill?
No.
Nope.
No, they're not.
Rek'Sai gets back on the slip and slide. I love this skin so much. It's great.
Do you?
It's great.
It's all right.
The water ski or whatever it is,
the
out
jet
of the base.
Ski.
It's just amazing.
Is that what you call it in Australia, water ski?
I think jet ski is probably more popular, but I've heard it.
You know, because water skiing is actually something very different. That's why I asked.
I probably just failed as much.
Papa, you never admit that. You just say, that's how we do it down under, mate, and then you get away with it. I don't know. I've never been to Australia.
You've never been to Australia? You've missed out, mate.
I know. I want to go, but it is a little bit tricky right now for me to do that. Can't just get up and take a holiday.
You have been to the next best thing in Hong Kong, Ned Kelly's Last Stand.
That's true. Great bar. If you ever are in Hong Kong, go to Ned Kelly's Last Stand. That place is amazing.
That's some amazing free advertising you just gave.
I am not, in fact, sponsored by Ned Kelly's Last Stand. It's just so good that I recommend it.
Neither is Aaron. There's not much to talk about in this game. It's not quite Panic Stations for Jinair like last game, but 5,500 gold maybe.
Well,
maybe that tells a tale.
They've already missed their biggest window to actually siege with this quality.
Are we sure they had any windows? Did we accidentally give them the room with no windows? Because I've watched two games now. Windows have been closed.
Nagne actually just going to pop it. There's the cleanse, though. Nagne has to back off. He uses Summoner Heal just to get a little bit of speed, but they can't actually get the gank off. Again, there's just no initiation. Someday starting to turn this around now. Trace gets caught out of the side. Mega Gnar comes through. He gets the stun on the score, and he gets the Gnar into the wall, but how much hope is there? And he gets it onto Winged. There's, oh, Someday, is he gonna die? No, he's not. Flashes out. Kill onto Pilot. Arrow, he's hungry for more. Flash onto Che. Arrow, maybe a little bit too far, but he does actually live. The dream of the perfect game is still alive. KT team fighting their way to a mid-turret kill, and there is no longer any threat from Jinair.
The ultimate irony, Monte Cristo. Jinair didn't get an ILC.
They didn't.
Nope. No windows.
No windows. Stuck in the middle of the plane.
Stuck in a rut of the Jinair Green Wings. This has been kind of unfortunately.
How does this keep happening? All right, let's take a look at this replay.
So, I mean, Trace is just so damn squishy in the front line. He doesn't have the tankiness. It's a great time to transform. Nice two-man Gnar. But if we're talking about a couple of extra thousand gold, that's going to be a different team fight. But they go for some very aggressive turret diving. I love the fact that Arrow wants a double kill here. He's like, I'm going to get both of these. Doesn't get either. Almost dies. But
dangerous.
KT can play like this when you're 6,000 gold ahead at 20 minutes.
Yeah, it looks like he was just looking for a crit, didn't find it. But KT keep on moving forward. They keep on taking these objectives. They have a 7,000 gold lead right now with only 6 kills. But they're flawless when it comes to those dragons and turrets. Oh no!
Uh-oh, it's looking bad, Monte
Cristo. No, the dream!
I mean, the dream of never dying is alive.
Okay, I guess I can take that. Oh, perfect game. Ruined because Someday doesn't want to aggressively and stupidly defend his tower. Still, KT will get the better end of that trade. Definitely the right call to make in that situation.
I like the fact that you backhandedly endorsed a stupid play. You're like, just defend it. You need to keep it up.
He actually probably had the resist because he has Cowl and Shroud.
Okay, now you're just going too far. You're rationalizing things you shouldn't be rationalizing. This is dangerous.
I'm starting to make excuses. No, it's fine. It was the better trade. KT definitely making the safer call there.
So much control open for score. Love this player on Rek'Sai. Definitely doesn't take a lot of the team's gold, but he's just so smart. He plays his control junglers so well. You know, he's kind of smart as an AD carry were apparent many years ago, but the fact that he's transitioned so seamlessly into this jungle role and now is really in the upper handful, credit to him for reinventing him, even at a older age than we expect. KT.
And there's the Sivirolt going down. They are just going to all flash forward. Look at that. Tibber has just bounced to the side with the Monsoon. There's not enough there to actually save Che. They get another turret on the bottom side with Pilot, but at what cost? KT firmly in control of the mid lane and the top lane right now. They could trade actually 2 tier 2s if they're aggressive enough. Score just on the outside of that Death Ray going to tap GBM with the Prey Seeker.
Okay, we made a mistake. Actually moved the the Tibbers quite late, so they probably could have taken this turret a bit faster, but not going to be punished at all. Take that out of turret. 5-2 is the turret score. So all the dream of the perfect game is dead. The objectives just keep stacking up for KT.
Well, and you can't fault KT for the way they're playing the map either. Just moving so seamlessly. The rotations are real this game. Arrow gets some more damage down, but GBM will make his way back into the top side, and they're going to have to abandon the tier 2 in the top for the moment. They can fall back to this Baron, maybe try and clear out some wards before they recall.
I think it's time to get excited about KT Rollster, Monte Cristo.
No, Pop Smithy. No, I know what happens when I get excited about KT Rollster. They don't go to Worlds.
But they win IEM. One time.
They won Champions.
That's true. KT rolls to Arrows a year ago. Maybe it's time. The repeat.
I'm just... No. No, Papa.
Look, it's been a couple of days since SKT played. I've forgotten what they're even like. KT looked like the best team in Korea.
I've been burned by this before. I've been burned by this before. I can't.
Ever since I can't first chatted it. With you in, I believe it was 2012, just when you got to Korea, you were well on the KT Bullets hype train.
Hey, it was deserved. They were the second best team in the world at the time of World Championships. They just, circuit points didn't work out for them. They had to play SK Telecom in back-to-back best of fives.
It's just sad that in the international scene, you know, this many years in, they're still relegated to being a bit of a footnote when, you know, we all wonder what could have been.
What can you do? I actually didn't have a lot of faith in KT Arrows at Worlds last year. I thought even if they were going to go, even if they went, they were going to choke because they were just, their play style was overly aggressive, which made for risky situations.
You were in a dark place around then, Monty. That's just the lack of optimism.
I didn't have a lot of faith, I will say that, in KT Arrows last year. But we'll see how this KT team does to round it out. Certainly they don't have a lot of circuit points, so they would have to make a very epic run through the playoffs and the qualifier in order to make it, unless they were to do something like win the entire season, which, given SKT's current form, doesn't seem particularly likely.
Every time a challenger to SKT's streak comes up, I ask for one thing and one thing only, Monstrous. It's not too much to ask. I want them to win game one of a best of three against SKT.
Yeah.
Make it a series. That's fun. That's drama. That's what we want to see.
Yeah, force at least SKT to have some sort of comeback as we see another tower fall for KT. They finally return to that tier 2. They're starting to ping down. They want to defend against the Gnar, and that's going to be Maokai's job.
Maokai, the solo killer of Gnar earlier in this game. And something that made everyone very surprised to the extent that you didn't even notice it, because why would you think about it?
Why would I? Why would I be looking at that when I could be watching the ganks happening around the mid lane?
Sivir picks up the wave. Arrow looking to boost his Scuttlecrab win rate.
Does he even care about the Last Whisper this game, and why should he? There's no armor on Gnar.
There's no armor at all.
Yep.
Anyway, like not even a cloth armor.
And as if there wasn't any actual threat onto Arrow already, having a BT will just make sure there is never any at all.
We should have kept the damage received graphs. It would have been about zero last game. Every time we saw Cogmore just wading through the team, chilling out.
Well,
so third dragon being started. Tracing a nice spot, but he doesn't have any Gnar bar raised at all. He wants to find something to auto attack before we start a fight.
Someday.
Two games of Gnar. No massive Mega Gnars really to write home about.
Well, he doesn't have any setup this game. I mean, what are you going to do?
Kill Pentaboom, maybe?
Oh, actually, the stun was used on the Banshee's Veil. There's the glory. And Peekaboo gets a little bit of help out with his team. Here comes the TP. They're going to flank with the Maokai. Oh, boy, he's coming in. And here he goes. He's coming from the side. There's a big Timbers onto GBM. Something gets all over him. GBM actually flashed that, but can't get out. Pilot will be doomed. Nagne getting very low in the front line, but is he actually going to die? He will. The first kill of the series is picked up by Trace, but that is a rather pyrrhic victory as GBM has spent this entire team fight running away from the mega tank that is Someday, and they will chain this directly into a Baron. Wing too low to contest. He's not even going to be there in time with Arrow still alive. Someday waddling over to the dragon right now with that Maokai, or Baron rather. So dragon taken by KT, and then the Baron.
The Che getting there quite swiftly, actually can't even get any closer to check, fearful of any sort of anti-CC coming through. It's going to be the freest of free barons to KT Rollstar.
Yep, there it goes. Score says, why would I use... What's he doing? He's not even using the smite.
He's waiting.
He's waiting for Nagne.
Wow. You know you're winning when, you know, because your mid lane is always like, oh, I'm coming back up soon, guys. And you're like, shut up. But this time around... Have a Baron buff.
Wow. Yeah. That is a very confident hold. You see that so rarely these days. And the reason why is there are many sneaky junglers with a lot of movement and ways to get back into the pit. And frankly, the teleport on the top laner also usually shuts that down, because if he comes in and just pops in there with some sort of burst, you will not be having a good time.
But sometimes you get to have your cake, eat it too, decorate it, maybe just put a nice message on it, like, we love Peekaboo, and,
Oh, man. Well, Arrow's doing a good job this series so far.
I love the fact that he can play Sivir and Cogmore. Like, there's no, like, identity overlap there at all. They're exactly the opposite.
That's all you need. May not be able to play Corki, but at least he's got those two.
This is like the junglers that can only play Lee Sin and then just fail every other skill shot. And you're like, how does this happen?
Arrow could also play Vayne, to be fair.
He can also play Draven, sort of, maybe.
He can play Draven, it's just Draven is terrible.
I'm not on the Draven hype, on the Draven hate train.
Get out.
I'm not on the Draven hype train either.
Crystal apologist.
I think Crystal last season was a really good Draven.
Thank you for bringing that point.
He was, though. Did you see the game? Two Mikhails?
That was actually a really hilarious game, I will give you that. If you guys don't know, the Draven from Crystal, they actually used a support and jungle Mikhails with a jungle.
No, no, this story is so much better. This is against IG, so they got surprised by the Draven game. One, it happens, right? Late pick Draven. Game two, they literally picked Lissandra, like Quadra Lockdown Vi.
Yep.
And then they just got two Mikhails and he was fine.
Okay, well, is this going to be the final push? Wing to the front line is going to chrono break mysteriously back into the enemy team and die. And here comes GBM. He just gets annihilated by the damage. Looks like Pilot will dodge the petrifying gaze, but not to any real advantage. Baron still coming in. KT just a little bit low, but the Peekaboo at full HP. He does not have flash to engage if they need it. Can they actually push this into a win?
15 seconds on Wayne, GBM still 30 seconds out. After getting quite close range to auto attacks, Arrow was taking the turret a couple of times. Might actually be pulled back, I guess, given the timings.
Yeah, I mean, they're just too low right now on Someday and Nagne, especially with that Victor back up sooner rather than later.
The house went in the slip and slide.
Is that what you live for?
I do. It was really funny. Also, Trace building a Frozen Mallet second, when there's just not going to be any scenario where you're free-ordering Maokai in some sort of 1v1 Squid Push. I think you have to build for team fights, even though,
man,
you know.
That is really bad.
Yeah, it doesn't do anything in the team fight at all. Maybe if they tank turrets for that extra little bit because you slowed them?
I guess there is that vain hope that you can split push yourself an advantage, but it's just...
Okay, could you look at Maokai's items just to clarify that statement of precisely everything? And the Guardian Angel coming soon?
He's going for that GA.
Can you slow him the second time when he comes back?
There's no hope.
See, this, I think Jungle Echo is a really good pick, and it's been shown in LPL. It's very high priority there. This is not a Jungle Echo comp in the slightest.
No.
There's nothing to gank anywhere. Ever.
I actually do like it with a different top laner, because at least if you're kiting with Victor and Corki, you can prevent people from engaging on you. But that's the only reason.
Trace taking a lot of damage in the front line. He's going to walk through. I mean, yeah, you throw out the parallel conversion, you throw out the Victor W. Okay, you have some sick zones for maybe some turret damage.
Good.
I don't mind it there, but you can't have Gnar in the top lane.
No. Pick one. Pick one in this composition. Both of them do not work together. KT just going to move into the top lane now. The super minions have to be dealt with because there's only one Nexus turret, but nobody can handle KT as they walk forward. Parallel convergence not going to work right there. Wing looking for an opportunity. Here's the engage. Pilot finds himself twisted advanced on. Here comes Arrow. He's getting a lot of auto attacks. There just isn't any engage. They get a Gnar ultimate, but it's just too late. There's no follow-up damage. And now Nagde will take out Gnar. Just going to zone everybody inside of the base. No one can actually get out of the fountain right now, so a clean victory. And KT will end a best of three, only allowing Jhin Air a single kill. And what? No dragons? No dragons.
Yeah, lucky number 13 both times. 13-0 in game one. 13-1 is the kill score in game two. That may be a record in terms of lowest overall kill score in a best of three, but what a performance from KT, and building up momentum. This is a team, as I said, coming to Korea in week three, I was thinking, okay, this team playing smart, doing some smart things, started to cast them. Wheels came off. They had a very poor 3 or 4 weeks. Ever since Peekaboo's come in, 4-series win streak. They're just playing smarter, and the score Peekaboo duo, very good to watch.
Yeah, I know how win streak teams go when they run into SK Telecom, though. However, a very important victory for this KT team. They want to take that third spot because we do have that gauntlet playoffs. If they could manage to unseat KU, it would be absolutely huge for them, because that would mean another, just one fewer best of three that they have, and they need those circuit points if this team has their eyes